Hello and welcome to The Big Fight, where this week we are going to really take a look at Aadhaar. Yes, we've all read the Supreme Court judgment. We've seen the arguments on both sides. We've seen what the dissenting note was. And we've had some time to actually try and understand what it all means. Now, obviously, this verdict has bearings not just for Aadhaar itself. It has got broader implications for privacy and technology and what sort of a role should all of this play in our life and what is the future of the India stack and are we going to go to a digital India and are we not? So lots and lots of questions thrown up by this, which is why we're going to sit back a little bit on this show and try and take a look at some of the broader implications of this. Actually, we've got the panel of just about everybody who's had a major role to play in this one way or the other. So let me start by welcoming onto the program Rahul Narayanan, who's a lawyer for the petitioners. So great to have you with us. And we also have Zuhaib Hazain with us, who's the lawyer for UIDAI. So both of you here with us. Nikhil Pawa, who's had more to say on the subject than anybody else on the entire planet. So I'm so glad that you can be here to tell us, well, everything that you think is important to say. I won't get you to give a sneak preview. Mohammed Khan is joining us, top lawyer and also spokesperson of the Congress Party. Ritika Khera joining us from Ahmedabad, economist, social activist. Again, someone with really, 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 really strong views on the subject. So, Ritika, don't hesitate to express them shortly. Somebody with equally strong views, Shankar Iyer, also joining us from Pune. And Nikhil Kumar joining us from Bangalore, fellow of the ISP-IRT Foundation. So as I said, all the major players who had something to say on the subject, all here on this program. Okay, let me see. Whom do I start with? Who won this, actually? That's the first question to ask. Nikhil, should I start off by asking you that? I'm going to get both the lawyers to say whom they think won. Who won?
Well, I think the people of the country lost from that perspective. This is essentially a verdict that allows the government to detain Aadhaar, which is the basis for a surveillance system. We've all lost. The UIDAI clearly won. The government clearly won. But the battle for essentially ensuring that people are able to get their benefits without an Aadhaar, for ensuring that people don't have to give a unique identifier for everything that they do, at least with respect to government and subsidies.
Private companies can't, though, ask
I think it. That's one major victory, that private companies are now barred from asking for Aadhaar. So for everyone here, your mobile operator can't ask for an Aadhaar, your bank can't ask for an Aadhaar, but the tax collector can.
Okay. So you're saying you're not quite sure who won, but the people of the country lost is what you're saying. Nikhil Kumar, let me get you in on that note.
In my opinion, I think the people of the country won. Aadhaar has been a tool of inclusion. The founding principles of Aadhaar has been upheld. The primary challenges on security and surveillance has also been very clearly ruled by the Supreme Court. So what this means for us is Aadhaar is here to stay. From a common man's perspective, I'd like to clarify is that what is changing for you is you will not be forced to link mandatorily your Aadhaar to a bank account or a phone number. You're only mandated for if you're getting any benefit from the government or in case if you're tax filing, you have to link your Aadhaar to your PAN. Other than this, nothing changes for you. If you voluntarily want to use your Aadhaar and get a SIM card from a private company or from a loan from a credit NBFC, you can still continue to do so. I expect the UIDAI and the regulators in the coming weeks to come out with clarifications on this.
Ritika, I know Nikhil Pawa is itching to say something in response, but I'm going to come back to you. Ritika, what do you think happened?
So I view the Aadhaar project as a big data meets big brother project. Section 7 is the big brother and Section 57 is big data. Section 57 has been struck down as unconstitutional, so that's a partial victory. In the longer run, I think people will win because it's not easy to forget that Justice Chandrachur has totally accepted the petitioner's point of view and has argued very explicitly and very clearly why he thinks that the petitioners were right.
But he's one out of five, right? He was overruled 4-1, so how is that How does that like prove anything?
Yeah. So I think, you know, even in the Section 377 battle in 2013, the Supreme Court overruled Delhi High Court, but in 2018, they had to change their mind. So, you know, this is what a democracy is like. You win some, you lose some, but you continue to fight back and you take what you get in the meantime. So I think eventually, just like Section 377 was struck down by the Supreme Court, the day will come when Justice Chandrachud's opinion will be the majority and a unanimous view.
In theory, but we'll have to wait for that actually to happen. I'm going to come to the two lawyers then, Mohammed Khan.
Well, I think we can't reduce it to binaries of who won and who lost. We have to take into account that the Supreme Court had the unenviable task of balancing multiple competing concerns. There are indeed good things in this judgment, fantastic things in this judgment. The striking down of Section 57, the restoration of sovereignty back in the individual, because earlier your data belonged to the UIDAI and you couldn't file any complaints if it was stolen or misused. But they have changed that. The Supreme Court has said you can file these complaints now and you can take action in case of theft or breach. So there are very important things. But at the same time, the judgment does fall short of our expectations in some regards. We wished, and this was the primary challenge that the Congress put out in our petition, Jairam Ramesh versus Union of India, where we said this is not a money bill. Because, and this has been addressed by Justice Chandrachud, and I quote him, that this amounted to a fraud on the Constitution. Those are very strong words coming from one of the most respected judges of the Supreme Court. A fraud on the Constitution. He reminded the government.
So that's a second point. That's a second point. An important point, but it's a second point.
But coming back to this, I think ultimately you can't say it's a win or a loss.
Can a government use a money bill to push through legislation? It's an important point, which I think needs to be looked at. I'll do that also in a couple of minutes. But Shankaraiah, parking that particular, the money bill question aside for a second, just wanted to get your overall take on the judgment, who won, who lost, where do we all stand now?
Well, the Supreme Court has saved the baby and thrown out the bathwater. Arguably, some more bathwater needs
Justice
to be thrown.
Justice Sikri said exactly the opposite. He said for the exclusion of a 3% population, 97% cannot be denied the benefits. Don't throw out the baby along with the bathwater. That's what Justice Sikri said.
That's what I'm saying.
It was 0.2%, Vikram. It was not 3%.
Fine, 0.2%, whatever the percentages were. Yeah, carry on, Shankaraiah.
I said the Supreme Court has saved the baby and thrown the bathwater out. Aadhaar has been restored to its original concept, which was for delivery of welfare, services, goods, and entitlements. And the most stunning thing for me in that judgment is, okay, they've taken out 57 and stuff like that. But in many ways, the Supreme Court has reset the citizens' state relationship. I have never seen a case where the court has sort of done a forensic analysis of the Aadhaar Act 2016, and so many sections have been 33.1, 33.2, 47, they sort of pulled no punches on that. Okay. And in a sense, this is a very good template for Aadhaar to be improved upon. I think there are several unanswered questions there. That includes the redressal mechanism. So, okay, the earlier the government had taken away the right to appeal, redressal, and complain, and so that's been restored in 47. But the more other important points is to get the redressal mechanism going. We know that the Supreme Court has said that as of now, the silos can't be merged, which has been the case. But the fear of Big Brother, the fear of taking this to all ambits, that requires some kind of governor there. And I think the court, the government may approach the court again for certain clarifications. But the important thing that the Supreme Court has established is that Aadhaar is not a magic potion for every damn thing that ails the government.
Let me just get the two lawyers in the case. Like, how do you think it went? I came to you after we'd heard the others, but each of you, what do you think happened? How would you analyze where we stand after this particular verdict?
So I would like to get one thing out of the way, because Nikhil used the word surveillance. Big Brother was also used. Now, all five judges have been unanimous on one thing, that there was a legitimate state interest. Even Justice Chandrachur concurred with Justice Sikri in saying that, yes, there was a legitimate state interest. What the act failed, as according to Justice Chandrachur, was with regard to whether it is proportional or not. That is, whether the interference was proportionate or not with the right to privacy. But as far as whether there was a legitimate state interest in terms of furthering targeted delivery of subsidies, benefits and services, even Justice Chandrachur said that, yes, that was the aim of the act, and that cannot be second-guessed by us any longer.
Okay.
So that's one thing that I want to get out of the way. As far as the act is concerned, it has broadly been upheld. The Justice Sikri, speaking for the majority, has said that has applied the test of dignity as a community value. He has said that this is a unique case where dignity and the right of privacy in the same person has to be balanced along with the right of that person to lead a dignified life. So if he has a right to have basics as subsistence, and the government is ensuring that through Aadhaar as a tool, it is ensuring better access to it, which was earlier being pilfered away, then we have to balance these two. Okay. So therefore, it becomes very important to understand that the court has painstakingly done a balancing exercise, and not at the cost of liberty. Therefore, it has struck down many things, but retained the essential heart of it.
So would you agree with that? I think that's the sense I'm getting from at least some of the people on the panel, that at the end of the day, when you analyze it, when you've studied it closely, it's kept some of the best bits and bits and thrown away some of the bad bits. Is that a fair way of looking at it, or no? Is it disappointing? Nikhil was disappointed when
we
started.
It's a little disappointing
this.
For us as well. We've been fighting this battle for a long time, but I think that even the portion that has been retained, it has been severe. The wings have been severely clipped, so to speak. And one should always remember that it hasn't been retained with great joy or with great affection. The court has said, on the basis of a presentation given by Dr. Pandey to the court, one, on the basis of ignoring all the data points which we had put forward. And three, on the assumption that the act will go according to the way Dr. Pandey described. So these are basic factual points on which the court, because of which the court has come to the view it has. And I think it's certainly open to us and to other people in the future. If they are able to prove that that factual basis is wrong, then the entire project will go.
It's wrong.
Fine. Let me just try and dissect this and help people understand this. Let's just look at, for example, what the court said, that you've got to balance the privacy of a few with the dignity of a majority, right? I think that's what Justice Sikri more or less specifically says. First of all, the requirement of Aadhaar in service delivery. Let's just spend 2 or 3 minutes or 5 minutes if we can. Let's just look at that. Is Aadhaar something that is required or essential or necessary or even extremely helpful in service delivery? Ritika, let me get you in on this, and then I'll start with the others. Isn't Aadhaar something which will help in service delivery?
If you want to do direct benefit transfers, what you really need is to have a good banking infrastructure with rural branches, enough counters there. And that kind of modern banking system existed in India even before Aadhaar appeared in the picture. So, there's been a lot of propaganda, and people have been made to believe as if Aadhaar, if you don't have Aadhaar, you can't even have bank accounts. So that's one thing. And in fact, what we've been seeing is that because of Aadhaar linkage with the banking system, it's actually now beginning to cause a lot of problems. People's bank accounts are getting cross-seeded with other people's Aadhaar numbers, and then the money starts going elsewhere. So I feel that the government the previous one and this one, both of them have done a lot of propagandist advertising to make people believe that this is going to eliminate corruption. Let me give one small example. People think that having biometric authentication at the time of taking your PDS rations is going to eliminate corruption. But if the dealer could force me to sign in a register on 35 kilos and give me only 32, that same dealer can do exactly the same with the biometric machine. He'll make me biometrically authenticate 35 kilos and still give me 32. So, the role of Aadhaar in delivery of benefits and entitlements, they're not benefits, they're entitlements. Some of them are legally protected, they're mandated by law. That, I think, has been really misrepresented to the judges, and I'm glad that at least Justice Chandrachud was able to see through all of this and to come to the crux of the matter, which is, first, said, that you don't, it's not necessary,
just to add to
and
that.
Two, that actually it is causing a lot of harm to a lot of people. 6% is a figure that the UIDAI themselves have submitted. It's in Justice Sikri's own opinion that 6% people, you know, their biometric authentication doesn't work. And the UIDAI just says we've got an exemption circular, but actually who's implementing that exemption circular
okay.
on the ground?
I get you. I hear you. I just want to go to Nikhil Kumar for a second on this specific point on service delivery and then issues around biometrics. I'll just come back to the other Nikhil as well. Nikhil Kumar, I mean, respond to what Ritika said. She said it's not really helping in service delivery.
I understand Ritika's expertise and she's done a lot of great work in this area. But I'd like to give you a bird's eye view of how Aadhaar has actually been implemented and used in the direct beneficiary transfer program. So to give you context, Ritika has been arguing to say that people couldn't open a bank account before Aadhaar. Yeah, absolutely, that's not true, right? So she's right. You could open a bank account even without an Aadhaar. But to put this into context, India's banking penetration, before the government started the Jan Dhan program was actually around 30 to 40%, right? And in the last four to five years, we have basically opened around 300 million bank accounts. And to open this bank account, there was a new product created. So this was the Jan Dhan bank account. And the feature of this product was, if you are anyone, it didn't matter, you could walk into a bank and provide your Aadhaar and open an account. And it had a feature of almost 5,000 rupees as OD. And what this enabled is, since people opened the bank account, now Aadhaar could be used now as a payment address.
Okay.
So your LPG subsidy and so on, which used to be given the other way, now started coming into your bank account directly. So this is one way of using Aadhaar for subsidy, wherein you're able to identify the individual and use this as a payment
what
address to send money directly to your bank account.
And
the recent World Bank survey says, out of all the bank accounts, once again,
Ritika,
let me complete, Vikram, please. A recent World Bank survey says, in the last 3 years, of all the bank accounts opened in the world, 50% of them have opened in India. We have the best gender ratio in terms of banking. So that is what Aadhaar has enabled from a DBT perspective. Second is when Aadhaar is used as an authentication point, which is where Ritika and others have worked extensively on, which is if I am eligible for ration and if I walk into a ration shop, I need to basically authenticate myself. And there have been a lot of challenges in this authentication issues, and the court has clearly identified this and they have said that we are not letting this pass. We are not letting this go lightly, and they have recommended that make sure all the other IDs are enabled and people are not excluded.
Okay, let me just get her in.
I just want to conclude with one sentence. This program has been lauded by everyone across the world. India has become a model for social inclusion, financial inclusion.
Come on.
And you read the everybody, it's right from Bill Gates to Satya Nadella to a lot of technologists have actually commented and applauded this.
Okay, we heard you.
So let's not
your one-line conclusion
that
is...
there is data to prove that...
Nikhil, I have to wrap up your one-line conclusion. Ritika, respond. Other Nikhil is trying to say something. Shankar, let me just broad make it. It's now go very quickly to a bunch of people. Ritika, quickly respond, then the other Nikhil.
Yeah, so a very quick response. You know, in 2008, there was a circular from RBI that made it very easy for people to open bank accounts just on the basis of their NREGA job cards. And that the scale of financial inclusion, as they call it, opening of bank accounts, was comparable to what has happened with Jan Dhan, Aadhaar, etc. Yeah, and to put LPG subsidy into my bank account. Today, my bank account is not linked to Aadhaar and I still get my salary and whatever else. I don't get LPG subsidy, but anything else that I have to get from the government. So this
ma'am, we are not talking about you. We are talking about people who get benefits into their bank account.
That's complete bunkum, and that's where the big data comes
Ritika,
in.
This is not about your bank account.
Listen, even this system, does not reduce corruption because
big data, we are talking about people getting their rightful money. There's no big data here.
Benefits or reducing corruption or inclusion.
So I'm going to give you a
please
case.
Please don't deflect, Ritika.
Because I'm going to give you a case from a couple of months ago, where in Surat there were two fair price shop owners who were arrested because someone had complained that they hadn't gotten their subsidies. They found that they'd installed a software which had copies of biometrics and was using that to funnel the subsidies out. So, you know,
that's
these
the problem,
systems
right?
are...
Indian Jugaad will come up with anything.
Indian, and the number of hacks...
If you have to use Jugaad, you can theoretically...
The number of hacks and the security issues are piling up. And there was a point that was that Rahul Narayan had made about, you know, the UIDAI CEO saying that the system is foolproof and secure and the court accepting that. We have seen innumerable instances of hacks of the software, enrollment software being hacked. So we don't know how many fakes there are in the system. We've seen an unrestricted access
You're
by...
You're mixing up so
by,
many things,
I'm
Nikhil.
Sorry, but let me speak, please. We've seen instances of village-level entrepreneurs being able to access the Aadhaar database with read-write permissions where you can make changes to the database. The system is not secure. The UIDAI is incapable of maintaining the security of the data.
Okay.
So we have a major problem over here.
I'm just going to come back. Shankar, I just want to come to you.
Vikram, please, if I may,
add one important point, Vikram. The most important part of this judgment is that now anyone whose data has been leaked, and it's been leaked for over 135 million people by 217 government websites, they can now go to court and sue the UIDAI. I think one major solution to all these issues will come with people being able to go to court against the UIDAI, because the government is preventing us from doing that earlier.
Shankar Iyer, I see your book, you know, the Aadhaar, a biometric history of India's 12-digit revolution, right next to you. What happens if somebody's biometric data gets hacked? If you hack my retina, if you hack my eyes or my fingernails, yeah. What can you do about it? You can't change your eyes.
Yes, Justice Chandrachud has expressed some doubts about and has raised very valid issues. But Justice Chandrachud also, in the privacy judgment, said that Government of India and other state governments have an obligation to ensure the benefits reach the beneficiary. And over 40 years now, India has been trying to figure out ways to do this. And the primary problem has been identity. Now, would the world, are there issues with the governance system? Yes. Are there issues with the UIDAI administration and the way UIDAI deals with complaints and issues? Yes. Are there issues with the Aadhaar Act? Yes. But let's not just get carried away that, you know, there are air crashes everywhere and we will not use an aircraft.
Aadhaar is not a proof of identity. This has been said by the UIDAI as well. There is no verification of that identity that is done. In fact, Aadhaar is not a proof of address. It's not a proof of identity. It's just a proof of authentication.
Finish what you were saying, Shankar, then I'll go to Mohammed Khan.
So the point is that there is a need to fix things. The concerns of the citizens about mass surveillance, about data theft, all of this is true. For the last 3 years, hackers in Germany and other places have been trying to enter the biometric. When I wrote this book, I spoke to the top expert, Bill Schneider, and he said the issue will never be with the core data, with the biometric. The issue will be leakage elsewhere. Is it anybody's case there that we have an entire electricity distribution system which out of which 25% of the electricity is theft? Every 1% costs 4,000 crores, and we lose roughly 1 lakh crore in electricity distribution.
But again,
should we shut that down? Should that be shut down?
No, Shankar, I get that, but you're still not. Shankar, I get that. You're still not answering the basic question I started with. I think it's a genuine concern which is expressed. If somebody's biometric data gets hacked or stolen, how can that ever be remedied?
Yes, if somebody's biometric is hacked and stolen, it's a major issue because the person can't have a different set of biometrics. Now, this is something that I had raised in the book also, and I have argued with the people saying, what is plan B? What is plan B? And that is something that I expected this judgment to take up. That is something I expect the Sri Krishna Committee draft to take up. That is something that Parliament should
But
take.
We don't have an answer, right, Shankar? For the moment, that's all I'm trying to say, that we don't have an answer to that particular question right now.
Two parts to the answer, Vikram. One, as of now, nobody's biometric has been hacked.
Terrorists haven't got a nuclear bomb and dropped it on Delhi. It doesn't mean you shouldn't worry about it.
No, but they have been hacked. They've been copied. Biometrics have been copied. There have been multiple cases of this happening.
Let me just try and get a broader panel into this. So you've studied this also at the grassroots level, both from the from the delivery point of view and also the simple question of theft that we are discussing.
So two quick answers to that. What happens if the biometric itself is stolen? What are the safeguards that is in the act and what are the safeguards on the ground? There is something, firstly, mere stealing of biometric will not enable access to anything to anybody. They have to also know your Aadhaar number. They'll also have to know your, maybe have some authentication, online OTP authentication. Now, secondly, what do you do assuming that unforeseen situation has happened, which so far has not happened from the UIDAI?
It has happened.
What do you do about it? You can
the
have Surat something
case,
called the...
It has happened.
You can have something called biometric locking, and that is provided for in the regulations. You can go ahead and lock your biometric, and it will not lead to any successful authentication. At the time when you want to authenticate...
But then after, sorry, I'm still struggling to forget. Is that what happens after that? Okay, you locked your biometrics, and I can never use my fingerprints or my eye ever again.
You immediately, when you want to authenticate...
Or I have to change my fingernails.
No, you do a one-time unlocking, authenticate, lock it back again.
Right, there, and a lot of people in this country know how to do that kind of a thing.
Okay,
or will
I'm
know
sorry,
how
I'm trying to get
that
you in on this, because no, I think this is one of the areas that you expressed concern on.
No, two or three quick things I wanted to say. One is, you know, the entire point of fundamental rights is that the ends don't justify the means. So the fact that this is a legitimate aim, proper delivery of services, I'm sorry, very poor excuse. And secondly, you know, when the project
Why is that not a major... Sorry, I'm not flipping the other side. Why is that not a major thing? We've had a situation where public services do not get to the required beneficiaries. This has been going on for 70 years. If you add the British times, it'll probably be going on for centuries. Actually, you can go all the way back to Mughal times, probably. It benefits one getting to the people they were designed for. So why is it not a major concern?
See, there are several things to be said about this. There's always a need to improve existing systems completely, right? I mean, no one denies that systems are perfect or they don't need improvement. But the fact is, you suddenly remove all the old systems on the basis of this new system, which you haven't tested at all. And now you say that, oh, there may be problems, but okay, you know, the problems can be dealt with. So this program was sold, foisted upon us as this perfect program in which nothing bad can ever happen. And now the bad things are being shown, you know, you should work with us to improve it. I find that a little offensive.
Did you, but hang on, so let me just ask you this, because you were, in a sense, it was a Congress, when it first came into the Congress idea. Was it foisted or was it, had there been a lot of work done on this?
There was a lot of work done on this, actually, and there were three pilots conducted in Rajasthan, Hyderabad and Maharashtra. And on the issue of biometrics, actually, we found that old people particularly have a difficult time identifying because they have cataracts in their eyes, there are other issues, laborers have fingerprints rubbed off. There were multiple issues. Internet connectivity was a major issue in rural areas. So that is why every circular that we sent out said Aadhaar must be voluntary and not mandatory. But I want to make a larger point. I want to take a step away from the judgment because, as you said at the outset, we need to touch upon the context in which all of this is taking place. There is a severe trust deficit between the people and this government. That is why we're having this debate here. That is why we're having this debate elsewhere.
I don't think people would necessarily trust any government. It's
no,
not just this
why.
Government.
No one should trust
any government. The question is not about this government or any other government.
That is not a statement of opinion. I'll tell you why. First and foremost, let us not forget that barely a year ago, this very government stood in the Supreme Court and argued against the fact that anyone here has a right to privacy. It argued it has the right to go into your homes and collect whatever information they need about you. Yeah. They called it an elitist concern. If that didn't give you a window into their mind as to what their intention was, then I'm surprised. Okay. Number two, very important example. And Nikhil spoke about this to some extent. Whenever somebody brought to the government's attention that Aadhaar is not as secure as you make it out to be, they attacked the person complaining. Tribune ran a story that Aadhaar data is available for 500 rupees in the market. Did the government go and investigate those people? No, they didn't. They filed an FIR against the journalist who reported that story. There was a young man by the name of Abhinav Srivastav. He developed an app which accessed Aadhaar data in August of last year. They arrested him. But they never acknowledge that Aadhaar is insecure. And finally, this Vikram sir, when they brought it as a law, as they proudly claim, in the Rajya Sabha, we moved 9 amendments. 3 of those amendments were make it voluntary, make anyone opt out if they want to. And third, limit the usage of Aadhaar for identifying beneficiaries for government schemes. They rejected every single one of them. What does that tell you about their intention?
Ritik, I just wanted to ask you, is it about A government or B government or the issues across everyone?
Thank you very much. So, you know, the Congress has always been speaking in a forked tongue about this. Their letters and circulars said voluntary, but here sitting in Delhi, they were tweaking the software so that you could not apply for NREGA work unless you submitted your Aadhaar number. And the Congress continues today. So this is exactly like 377. There is no political party standing with people's concerns.
But they're just trying move to the amendments on the floor of Parliament. We have the courage of our conviction.
Every government loves Aadhaar, every opposition hates it.
So when they're in opposition, they hate it. When they're in power, they want it.
Okay. No, if that were true, then we would be implementing it on a war footing in Karnataka and Punjab.
Nikhil,
we have not done that.
Okay.
I respectfully disagree with this opinion that the Congress and the BJP have the same Aadhaar. We do not. Our Aadhaar was voluntary. There were voices within the Congress speaking out against Aadhaar.
They're all complicit. They're passing a law in Karnataka. I think already passed a law in Karnataka making Aadhaar mandatory for so many services. I wouldn't trust the Congress on this. I don't trust the BJP on this. People should not trust their governments. And dissent is patriotic. We have to question our governments. We have to dissent when we disagree with them. I wanted to just comment on one aspect which has not been covered in the judgment, and I wish it was, which is around the deletion of data. If our mobile operators and our banks have got data and they've taken an Aadhaar, and now they're not allowed to. Like Nikhil Kumar was wrong when he said that you can give your Aadhaar number voluntary. That is not the case. We should be allowed to withdraw our consent for giving that Aadhaar, that link should be disconnected and that data should be deleted. That is not covered in the judgment, and I want to know from the lawyers how we can actually address that.
Okay, I'm going to come to the lawyers to address that, but Nikhil Kumar, let me just come to you on that particular point. Can private companies still get that data, and how do you make sure that they do delete it?
Yeah, so if you look at the what this impact is, basically there are two types of authentication that happens. One is an online authentication and one is an offline authentication. And then on the other side of the matrix, think about allowed to store Aadhaar and not allowed to store Aadhaar. So the online and offline, so the online part takes care of the wording which basically says access to authentication services. Offline is obviously allowed for anyone. The court doesn't prohibit this. And in terms of storing and not storing, only, for example, if there is an act which allows you to store, which is storing means linking, right? In the language of storing means linking. So in the case of PAN, they've allowed linking, which means income tax can store your Aadhaar number. And there is another box, which is cannot be stored. So if you look at the most private entities who are basically using Aadhaar, these are mostly use cases around financial inclusion and health inclusion. So institutions like banks, NBFCs, you know, mutual funds, etc., who are basically providing financial services, fall under online authentication and cannot store Aadhaar category. So basically, what this essentially means is that the regulators in each of this, if they allow, voluntarily people can use. Access to authentication services will not be
Okay. There's some controversy around what you're saying. So Rao, let me just get you into this.
The only section under the Act under which private entities could use the Aadhaar was Section 57. In Section 57, they have categorically said, and all five of them have said, that private entities cannot use this.
Section 8. Section 8 is what defines requesting entity, and Section 8 also allows.
One of the problems of getting so many experts onto the panel is that the rest of us are now lost.
Listen, can I just ask you?
That's not a lawyer there.
Yeah, but
he's not a lawyer. These guys are.
So I'm just trying to, let me just try and establish this in a slightly non-technical manner, right?
Sure.
We could keep discussing Section 8 and Section 57 until all of our collective eyes glaze over, which they are about to do. So I'm just asking you, private companies, can they still misuse Aadhaar, yes or no?
They're not allowed to use it at all, is what I say. I haven't seen anything in the judgment which says that they can, because the Supreme Court has specifically struck them down, saying that, you know, use by private entities will lead to commercial exploitation of people, and it would lead to a massive privacy violation. It's unconstitutional and it is disproportionate.
And that is why they deal with mobile phones and bank accounts.
So, do you agree with him on that reading? And if you do agree with him on that reading, does that in a sense mean that entire concept of an India stack is now slightly shaky?
So, this will be part of my advice to my clients, so I can't talk elaborately on this, but I may not, on a close reading of the judgment, I may not entirely agree, because there are some parts which need to be harmonized in the judgment. So, and I don't want to give away those parts right away, but the point is that to what extent and in what manner, because the court was concerned about forcible consent, even arising out of a contract. Therefore, and that part was struck down. Therefore, in what manner can private companies still use it is still at large, and we have to understand that closely, and we are still examining that.
So can I just quickly come to all of you?
We've written an article on it.
One of the legal issues, which Mohammed Khan referred to, I'm going to ask you all of this question, and it did come up in the judgment. The fact that the government uses a money bill, right, and I'm going to ask all of you this question. The fact that you use a money bill to get some of this thing done through, that's one of the things Justice Chandrachud expressed a lot of concern about. Is that a problem? And can that come up again as a challenge for this?
Yeah, so that is one area where this court has overruled two prior judgments. And in fact, I would say that all five judges are ad idem on that part. That earlier the law was, there were two judgments, one of three judges and one of two judges, where they said that once the speaker certifies something as a money bill, it's a no-go zone for the courts. It's beyond the sphere of judicial review. Today, that law has been overruled. This court says that if we feel that there is substantial illegality, we can go ahead and scrutinize it. So that now leaves open all other exercise of parliament using the money bill route.
Okay, can I just ask you, do you agree with that? And is that potentially one of the more important aspects of the judgment?
It's in fact pretty much the most important. It's pretty much the most important aspect in the future. I mean, if you think about it, of course, digital rights, privacy, all of that extremely important. But the rule of law and constitution and government is always a massive concern as well. I think the implication for this is that if any government tries to pass again a substantive act like this as a money bill, they will face a lot of trouble in court.
Mohammed Khan, and then I'm going to come to the others out there.
See, the problem with the money bill, and why it's different from any other kind of bill, is that it cannot be voted upon in the Rajya Sabha. Whatever happens in the Lok Sabha is final. And why did the government do that? Because we've maintained for the last 4.5 years that this government sees parliament as an inconvenience to be managed. It's not just this bill. The amendments for the Tribunals Act brought in as a money bill. The fact that the Finance Act was supposed to be discussed in parliament this time, completely thrown to the wayside. The speaker is passing it, opposition members are standing there yelling, no discussion. Voting carried out and done. Number three, Mr. Chandra, you must appreciate the fact that in this case, this was not a money bill. We respect the court's decision on this matter, but we concur with Justice Chandrachud that it does not satisfy any of the requirements. Okay. Article 110 is very clear. Only Shankar, the items given therein can constitute a money bill.
Shankar,
this fails on every ground.
Shankar, is that one of the issues that you think we'll be all left discussing going forward? From everything that's happening around Aadhaar, the possible misuse of money bills for a government to push through all sorts of things.
So here's the thing, the Constituent Assembly had discussed this and has given a certain role for a certain reason for the existence of Rajya Sabha. The second point is, the issue is not whether, I mean, yes, this majority judgment said that it was a money bill and it was okay. So every time you have a preamble in a bill which says that every time government spends some money, I'm going to take it to the money bill route, I think that is not a good idea for democracy. So one, you have the committee route being bypassed. Second, the bills are being passed in 5, 7, 9 minutes. I think someday there will be a Usain Bolt record being broken in parliament at the speed at which bills are passed. Most importantly, should the decision about spending allocations, which is always in thousands of crores in India, be left to the wisdom, or should the burden rest only on one person, which is the Speaker of the House? Why can't the House vote on it?
There's actually a beautiful line in Justice Chandrachud's judgment. The Rajya Sabha is a safeguard against majoritarian rule. That is very important.
All that we've been seeing this entire month is the Supreme Court stepping in time after time after time to say you can't have just majoritarianism. There has to be the rule of law. And that's been happening a lot. So this is, I think, one of the things that has to be looked at. Nikhil, just want to get your take on this particular aspect of it. Do you think the government did something wrong by pushing it through as a money bill?
What I'm actually more concerned about, I mean, from an Aadhaar perspective, is we need to now start focusing on the data protection bill that's pending to be passed. And that's a more important bill than the Aadhaar Act itself. So I think from a law perspective, I'm looking forward to everybody in the ecosystem working together and making sure that we have a strong data protection regime. We need to be able to empower users with their data. The Supreme Court also clearly identifies this need in this judgment. So I feel personally that voluntarily not allowing someone to access his Aadhaar to services will lead to exclusion of mass numbers, and that will actually go in the opposite way of the argument that's being made. So Aadhaar has to be seen as an inclusive tool.
Okay.
And I hope all the regulators, UIDAI, will come together and come out with the right regulations.
Okay, what needs to be done next? I'm going to do a quick roundup of the entire panel. But before that, I mean, let's go to the audience.
I have a bank account in Kotak Mahindra Bank, and they have...
Don't give us your bank account numbers, please. Or your
No, you cannot believe what all is going to be possible. But
as soon as you get out of this program, you're going to get 30 people calling you from other banks saying, "Unke saath kyun hai? Hame de do."
But they have linked my Aadhaar card when I had gone to open my account. So how do I get my Aadhaar card back? Like Aadhaar, unlink the Aadhaar.
Okay.
Mera naam Manjit Kumar hai. Mera prashn ye hai ki jab Aadhaar ke sahayata se tamam kalyankari yojanaon se janta ko labh pahunchaya ja raha hai, to kyun log halla macha rahe hain? Ye to aisa desh hai jo darwaza bhi sirf tabhi band karte hain jab kapde change karna hota hai. To hamare liye privacy ka koi sawal hi nahi. Main apna mobile number har cheez dena
हमारे लिए प्राइवेसी क्यों? Actually, it's a really interesting. Okay, मैं आपसे सबसे पूछूंगा. Hang on a minute.
वही लोग हल्ला पहले मचाते हैं कि गरीबों के लिए सरकार कुछ काम नहीं कर रही है, और जब इसके हथियार बनाकर इसे काम किया जा रहा है, तो क्यों हल्ला मचाया जा रहा है?
Okay, actually, very interesting question. He says, why are you worrying so much about privacy? No, most people don't care. How many of you in the audience think privacy is really important? Okay, so actually, 70-80% do not completely agree, but I think it's an interesting viewpoint.
Yeah.
But that is okay. Now, fine. Hang on. I'm coming to all of you for final comments. One interesting comment being made with to whether privacy is at all important. B, how can you get back the data if somebody has already got it? So let me start with you, Zoe. What happens on that?
So I think
final thoughts from everyone now.
If you apply the spirit of the judgment, that data which they are no longer entitled to will have to be deleted.
So how does it happen now? Let's say you've got bank accounts that have been linked by Aadhaar.
Yes.
What happens now? Do they all have to delete it?
No, so that is being considered by the government. A decision will be taken by the highest quarter, and something will be worked out to comply with the judgment, whatever that
is. Okay, Ritika, let me get your thoughts on this. What essentially is going to happen now on the data that has already been taken?
I think it is a serious concern, and it is something that the government will have to do something to assure people that what the court has said about deleting this data will actually happen. Justice Chandrachud has raised this concern that all their previous interim orders were being blatantly violated by the government since 2013. Can I quickly say something about the questions that were asked? I think it's very interesting how people are concerned about the linking of their Aadhaar number, either with their mobile or bank, doesn't matter what. I think this is a big victory also for those of us who have been questioning Aadhaar, because people have become aware about the dangers of this kind of thing. And actually, when you ask them what is privacy, I think even the understanding of privacy needs to be deepened. And I think for that, the last year's privacy judgment was a very important thing. It's not just about whether I tell you who I had dinner with last night. It's not just that. It's about how privacy is the soul of a democracy. If the government has the ability to track our movements, then it has a chilling effect, and that curtails our right to the freedom of expression, which is so important for a healthy democracy.
Okay, we get it. Loud and clear. Quick last words from everyone else. Nikhil Kumar, very quick last words from you.
Vikram, I'd like to, clarify that, there have been definitely a lot of legitimate concerns around the use of Aadhaar from its mandatory linkage to security. All of these inputs need to be taken and UIDAI has to work. But let's be clear that the Supreme Court in a 4-1 verdict has very clearly upheld and has said that it's an inclusion tool. It enables a lot of people to get their dignity. It has enabled them to get their identity. It's secure. It's not made for surveillance. So the Supreme Court has very clearly come across. And I think that's what the user needs to know. Nothing changes for him. And life continues to be. And few of us who have been worried about privacy have to now proactively work and ensure that we send our comments for the data protection bill.
Okay. Shankar Iyer, final quick word from you.
See, the Supreme Court has fixed many of the issues in the use and deployment of Aadhaar in the expansion. There are crores of people who need this identity authentication instrument. So the focus should be on how to make it better.
Okay.
Remember that two different governments of two different persuasions and ideologies have both agreed on one thing, that is on Aadhaar. Okay, so let's not get carried away. There are issues of governance, there are issues of state capacity. These must be fixed. Two last points. One, there is a provision in the Aadhaar Act that allows UIDAI to cancel your Aadhaar. I think somebody needs to pull this out and work on it.
Okay.
Because a government that gives me an identity card cannot take it away. The second part, the Supreme Court says now the silos are cannot be merged. So we should work towards getting the Data Protection and Privacy Bill to ensure in letter and spirit in an act that these silos which contain information on the citizen are not merged, so that tomorrow somebody cannot connect the dots.
Okay, fair enough. Mohammed Khan, last quick word from you.
Two very quick points. We believe that this country is founded on the idea of taking down unjust laws. This is an unjust law. The Congress has fought it in Parliament. It has fought it in court now, and it will fight it in the streets. We promise that when we come back to power, and we said this in our press conference, this law will be severely re-examined.
Last quick word from you.
So a couple of days ago, there was a story that the Election Commission wants to link the Aadhaar to the voter ID. I'm not sure whether that's legal now or not, but I think we should be very worried about that and conscious of that. Number two, we have to be careful about the government trying to push in a new law to legitimize private parties collecting Aadhaar. That should not be allowed. Number three, I would urge everyone to write to your bank, to your mobile operator, their nodal officer, their email addresses are online. Please write to them asking them to delink your Aadhaar if you don't want it linked and ask them to delete your data. Let's just go at them and
but
tell them
we
don't want it.
But voluntarily say, look, it's okay if they have that. Not, I don't want to go through the hassle of getting it re-registered.
But it's not allowed for them to have it voluntarily. Section 57 has been struck down, as Rahul had explained.
Okay, so even if somebody says, I actually don't want to go to the headache of having to re-get a mobile connection or re-get a bank account, he says you may have no choice but to do that. Is that a correct
way? I don't think that's a correct way to look at it. And I'm certain that they can come up with many, many policy fixes for this sort of thing. Like if Aadhaar is the only document which you have given, although it's actually a number and not a document, but be that as it may, but you can surely give some other proof of identification. And it's actually recorded that 2 lakh people in this country out of 1.2 million don't have no other ID. Everybody else has something.
But are you saying, I'm just trying to understand, are we saying that even if somebody is okay with it, they have no choice but to now go and get the whole thing done again?
I think that's exactly what it says, because they said the Supreme Court specifically struck down the ability to do this by contract. You and I can't agree to do this.
What the Supreme Court says is private agencies cannot seek authentication. Those are the exact words. So that does not mean that they have to go ahead and delete, that each individual is incumbent upon them to go
so
and delete it.
So after all of this discussion and debate, clearly this is still an area that is going to require a certain amount of analysis, a certain amount of discussion, and perhaps further debate. We'll keep track of all that's happening and see also how that affects that crucial right to privacy and data protection, of which further bills are coming and we will no doubt hear a lot more on. Thanks a lot for watching. This is The Big Fight. We'll be back next week.